Yes, good morning. So today we are going to start the chapter Landscape of the Soul. So Landscape of the Soul, what does it mean? The landscape which we are going to view from intrinsic point of view. The landscape which will have intrinsic or inner point of view. Landscape is a beautiful view of a place. That is a landscape. But when we say landscape of the soul, it means that that view which is taken from intrinsic point of view. So which has an intrinsic point of view, that landscape. So landscape, as the title suggests, it is about the art form. So in this chapter, children, we are going to read about the artistic forms, basically of Chinese and the other one of European. Two art forms the writer is going to discuss in this over here. One is Chinese and the other is European. So where the landscape talks about the artistic forms. Yes. And the soul word talks about intrinsic view. So here, basically, in order to make the concept clear, the writer is taking two kinds of forms. One is Chinese art, and the other is European art. These are the two art forms of the world. One is Chinese and the other is European. And both of these art forms are totally different from each other. What makes them different? The way we perceive them. What makes these two art forms are different? These two art forms are different on the basis of our perception of them, the way we perceive them. Chinese art, you know, if you want to understand the Chinese art, then you have to delve deep into its work. Then you have to understand its inner, you know, self. What is inside the art? That needs to be understood if you want to understand Chinese art. But yes, European art is all about realistic. It's a realistic art. What is there, what seems to be, that is there. It's not about like whether this is better or whether this is better, but the thing is like both of these art forms are different. Okay, Chinese is all about intrinsic and European is all about realistic art. In order to convey like what Chinese art is or what European art is, the writer has written, he has given a few anecdotes, a few stories are there. So the concept, he's able to bring home the idea of the contrast between Chinese and European. The writer has written various stories inside. Through the stories, you will be having a clear view of what Chinese art is or what European is. And those stories are very interesting. Okay, so let's read those stories. And then in the end, we will be writing a statement on what Chinese art is and then what European art is. Let's enjoy the stories first. So a wonderful old tale is told about the painter Wu Daozi, who lived in the 18th century. So the story starts up. So first of all, the writer tells us about Chinese art. And when he talks about this, then there is a painter called Wu Daozi. Remember this name. So there is a very wonderful story about a painter called Wu Daozi who lived in 8th century. His last painting was a landscape commissioned by the Tang Emperor Xuanzong to decorate a palace wall. So the emperor asked him, the emperor asked this painter to decorate a wall. Okay, he was asked to make a wall painting by the emperor. Got it? This boy. So this Wardaozi was asked by the emperor to make a wall painting. So he was asked to decorate a palace wall. The master had hidden his work behind a screen, so only the emperor would see it. So when this Wardaozi made that painting, he hid it behind the curtains. His purpose was that only the emperor should see it, right? For a long while, the emperor admired the wonderful scene, discovering forests, high mountains, waterfalls, clouds floating in an immense sky, men on hilly paths, birds in flight, right? So when the painter, when Wardaozi told the emperor to see the painting, then the emperor was able to see the vast painting with so many things inside. What was there in the painting? There were, let me again speak those things which were there in the painting, right? But even then, the painter Wardaozi will tell him about something which the emperor never saw. So what was there in the painting which was visible to the layman's eye? Let me read it out. For a long while, the emperor admired the wonderful scene, discovering the forests, high mountains, waterfalls, clouds floating in an immense sky, men on hilly paths, birds in flight. So six things I've spoken. So the emperor was able to see so many things on that wall painting. Right? Look, sire, said the painter, in this cave at the foot of the mountain dwells a spirit. So emperor was not able to see the soul of the landscape. What's the soul? Yeah, meaning of the painting. The emperor was only able to see the physical aspect of the painting. Okay, what we are, that is not just how we look like. What we are is about what kind of soul we have. The moment soul is out of the body, this body is useless. Soul is all. So the painter, the emperor was able to see the physical aspect of the painting. He was able to see the forests, the mountains, the men on hilly areas, the waterfalls, the clouds, the birds. But then the painter Wardaozi told him to look at a cave which was at the foot of the mountains. The emperor was able to see the mountain, but he was not able to see the cave under that mountain. So the Wardaozi, the painter said, like, sir, look at this cave. It was there at the foot of the mountain. So he said, sir, look at the foot of the mountain. There dwells a spirit. The painter clapped his hands and the entrance to the cave opened. The painter clapped his hands and the entrance to the cave opened. Can you imagine that it was a painting? The door, the entrance of the cave opened with his clapping. The inside is splendid beyond anything words can convey. Please let me show you, your majesty, the way. The painter told the emperor that, sir, inside the cave you see magnificent view of the place. And please allow me to take you inside. The painter entered the cave, but the entrance closed behind him. The painter entered the cave, and the moment he entered, the entrance closed. Where was the emperor? Outside. Did the emperor enter the inside? No. Okay. The painter entered the cave, but the entrance closed behind him. And before the astonished emperor could move or utter a word, the painting had vanished from the wall. Number one, the emperor was outside. So before he was able to understand anything or say anything, the painting disappeared from the wall. Not a trace of Wu Daozi's brush was left. Even his brush was not there now. And the artist was never seen again in the world. Got it? So this is something very mysterious. But whatever. One thing is sure, that in order to understand Wu Daozi's painting, you have to read his mind. You have to enter his soul. You have to understand the art from deep within. That's why the title is Landscape of the Soul. It's not the landscape of the brush, landscape of the mountain. It's of the soul. So this is what Chinese art is. From this example, from the story of Wu Daozi, we come to know that art is not something to be appreciated from its physical aspect. It is something which has far more depths what we can ever perceive. Okay? So that's not all. Such stories played an important part in China's classical education. China's classical education is full of such stories. If you want to teach somebody what art is, you just cannot teach the person art through by making him draw a few things over here. Okay, you have to teach the child or the children the concept of this kind of art through the, and they do this through the classical education. The books of Confucius and Zhuangzi are full of them. Then there are two authors. Their books are very, very relevant if you want to teach classical education. They help the master to guide his disciple in the right direction. So the books by Confucius or Zhuangzi, they help the painters or they help the master to help their followers in the right direction. Beyond the anecdote. What's the meaning of anecdote? A small story. So beyond this anecdote, they are deeply revealing of the spirit in which art was considered. So in contrast to this story or another famous one about a painter who would not draw the eye of a dragon he had painted for fear it would fly out of the painting. So one story I've told you about Wu Daozi. He says that like there are so many other stories which talk about Chinese art. There is one more story where the painter, he painted a dragon. And in the end, he did not want to make its eyes. Because he thought like if I'll make its eyes, then the dragon will fly off. The painting happened to be so realistic. Can you imagine? So the dragon, the painter would not draw the eye of the dragon as he feared that it would fly out of the painting. So with an old story from my native Flanders that I find most representative of Western painting. So this story, you know, this is the representative of the Western painting. In 15th century Antwerp is a place. In 15th century Antwerp, it's a place. A master blacksmith called Quinten Matus fell in love with a painter's daughter. So this is a story which rolls back to 15th century in Antwerp, where a master blacksmith, his name was Quinten Matus. Quinten Matus fell in love with a painter's daughter. So once upon a time, there was a painter. There was a master blacksmith. Okay, what was the name of that blacksmith? Quinten Matus. He fell in love with the daughter of a painter. Blacksmith fell in love with the daughter of a painter's painter. You can imagine if it's a love story, blacksmith will not be allowed to marry the painter's daughter. What will the painter expect? He will expect that his daughter will marry a painter only. And the blacksmith will learn painting. And he will make a painting which will make the master blacksmith, master painter get so impressed that he will let his daughter marry him. But what kind of painting, what kind of, you know, art he learned, that is what the story is about. Okay, so I'm going to read out the story. Listen carefully. So in 15th century Antwerp, a master blacksmith called Quentin Matus fell in love with a painter's daughter. The father would not accept a son-in-law in such a profession. So Quentin sneaked into the painter's studio and painted a fly on his latest panel with such delicate realism that the master tried to swat it away before he realized what had happened. So what did Quentin do? Quentin wanted to marry that girl, but he would not be able to marry the girl unless and until the master painter was sure that his son-in-law was also a great artist. So what does Quentin do? He sneaked, he stealthily entered the studio of that painter, and there he drew a fly on a panel which he had made. So Quentin drew the, he drew a fly on that panel. So when the painter entered his studio, he first swat it like this. So he whisked the fly away. He tried to whisk the fly away. What does it mean? Yeah, it means that the fly which he had made, it was so realistic that the painter could not make it out. He tried to whisk it off. Right? So then later on he realized like what had happened. Quentin was immediately admitted as an apprentice into his studio. What is an apprentice? Trainee. So that very minute, the painter told this man Quentin to be his trainee. He started training him. He married his beloved and went on to become one of the most famous painters of his age. So this very Quentin later on became a very famous artist later on. These two stories illustrate what each form of art is trying to achieve. So these two stories convey us or tell us like what art is. A perfect illusionistic likeness in Europe. So if the second example which I have told you about Quentin is, it is from European art. Okay, where you talked about the story where he painted a fly, that is the European art. Because there, what is there? It was the example of illusionistic likeness. What is illusion? Something which is there but is not there. Illusion is eyewash, aankhon ka dhokha. So European art is an example of illusionistic likeness. Something which is illusion, but it is the copy of that. So the fly was not real, but it seemed exactly the same real fly. It is an example of illusionistic likeness, and it happens in European art. Okay, but in Chinese art, imagination. You have to be with the imagination of the artist. You cannot explore Chinese paintings with your own imagination. You have to read the Chinese artist's viewpoint. You have to enter the artist's soul. Then only you can understand that. So different, isn't it? European art is about what seems to be. Chinese art is what doesn't seem to be, what is not there. See how different, but it is so. So these two stories illustrate what each form of art is trying to achieve. So what these two forms are trying to achieve? A perfect illusionistic likeness in Europe, the essence of inner life and spirit in Asia. China is in Asia. What are the two, you know, what are the two missions, or you can say objectives of art? In Europe, it is to achieve perfect illusionistic likeness. Okay, in Europe, it is like, do you see something and you are able to relate it with the realistic? In Europe, it is to achieve the goal of perfect illusionistic likeness. But in China, it is the essence of inner life and spirit in Asia. About China, it is about achieving inner life and spirit. So Chinese art is intrinsic, European art is realistic. Intrinsic, realistic. See the difference. For China, inner. For Europe, outer and realistic. In the, and we people, what kind of art we follow? Do we follow the Chinese art or European art? Realistic, European. And European is modern art. That is what we follow. And 3D art. What is that an example of? Three-dimensional. So think about it. So there are many great artists in our class also, isn't it? Okay, so a classical Chinese landscape. In the Chinese story, the emperor commissions a painting and appreciates its outer appearance, right? In the Chinese painting, the emperor, he gets a painting and appreciates its outer view. But the artist reveals to him the true meaning of his work. The emperor appreciates, but the artist showed him the true meaning of his painting. The emperor may rule over the territory he has conquered, but only the artist knows the way within. Let me show you the way, the Dao, a word that means both the path and the method. Now, D-A-O, Dao is a word which means now both the path or the method. Dao means path or the method. Daoism. So when Dao told the emperor, like, let me show you the way. Now, Dao word has become synonymous with path or the way. And the mysterious works of the universe. The painting is gone, but the artist has reached his goal beyond any material appearance. So the painting is also gone and the artist has achieved his goal. What is that? To reach beyond the physical world. Right? A classical Chinese landscape is not meant to reproduce an actual view. So what's the purpose of the Chinese painting? The purpose of Chinese painting is not to make one more replica like that. When we talked about the Chinese painting, which disappeared, we didn't even have the copy of that. So that this is what he's saying, the Chinese landscape is not meant to reproduce an actual view as it would a Western figurative painting. Whereas a European painter wants you to borrow his eyes and look at a particular landscape exactly as he saw it from a specific angle. The Chinese painter does not choose a single viewpoint. His landscape is not a real one and you can enter it from any point. Okay, in order to understand Chinese painting, you can enter that painting from any viewpoint. Okay, if you are trying to understand the Chinese painting, then you may have your own interpretation unless and until the Chinese painter himself tells you what it is. So you may have so many viewpoints, But if you are looking at the fly made by a European artist, the fly will remain a fly. It will not become a dragon for somebody and a fly for somebody. So European painting is more realistic, whereas Chinese is imaginary, or where you'll have to seek the guidance of the painter. That person will only tell you like what it is about. Okay, the painter only can show you the path. So his landscape is not a real one, and you can enter it from any point, then travel in it. The artist creates a path for your eyes to travel up and down, then back again in a leisurely movement. This is even more true in the case of the horizontal scroll, in which the action of slowly opening one section of the painting, then rolling it up or to move onto the other, adds a dimension of time which is unknown in any other form of painting. So it also requires the active participation of the viewer, who decides at what place he will travel through the painting. So it's all about the Chinese painting, where you have to have your own time and space from your side. So here, the active participation of the viewer, who decides at what pace he will travel through the painting. A participation which is physical as well as mental. The Chinese painter does not want you to borrow his eyes. He wants you to enter his mind. You cannot understand a Chinese painting through what he tells you it looking like. You'll have to enter his mind. So the landscape is an inner one, a spiritual and conceptual space. So the Chinese painting is inner one. It is spiritual. It is a conceptual space. And you cannot understand it with your only eyes, right? So this much is enough for the day. We'll continue tomorrow. I guess it's a heavy chapter. Yes, here, children online. Children, did you get it?